Yes, so there will be lots of thumbnails and lots of slides, so the chaos needs to slow it down somehow. So I hope this will be a collective effort. There are two things you should maybe know about me before we started. And one of them is actually that it's the first time I announced it. Premier. So to speak, and so I already mentioned, I think, that I came from engineering. And I turned into an applied mathematician. Slash numerical analysis person. And I believe I'm in transition to turn into something else. What is it? Yeah, I do think it's a bit. Pretty close. Anything else? Any other questions? I mean, you got already pretty close. But it's worth the fact to say. And frequency. So I guess I came into the field here, like many of us from applied mathematics, I think if you really want to make progress in understanding a lot of algorithms being used, especially within this triangle of engineering and the whole topic of this program, you have to try and fix it somehow, right? You have to take the data seriously, you have to believe that there is actually a primary and you have to talk about uncertainty also in this context, essentially, right? There's a basic uncertainty, but I think the real thing is basically constructivist data, and then you have to know how to estimate the data, and then cover it, because you have to start stuff if you're a I think it's really also the triangle that we hopefully gonna explore in the next 6 months. So I'm also particularly excited because some of the deep dives that we're gonna have are involving real data and absolutely real data. Just a question, I mean, how many of you consider yourself as an engineer in the audience?
Or frequentist, or particular.
Okay, no, it's a few, I suppose. And the rest is applied, right? Applied math?
Okay.
Anyone else? I mean, any category? No, that's out? Pure math? Yeah. Okay. But I think that's, what also you tried tackling in your program how many years ago. I think that was also a bit of 5 years ago, but sort of the interface between statistics and hopefully we can make some progress, right? Anyway, I find this incredible liberating, increasingly considering myself a scientist, because now I'm still using Bayes, but I'm using Bayes to construct algorithms. And I'm not too religious about it, or you will see that I'm actually getting pretty loose about it. So it's just a mental framework for me now to get efficient, recursive algorithms for estimating. And then ultimately trying to understand them from a sequential perspective, if you do that, some kind of coverage property, et cetera, et cetera. And I think that's the early timer, but actually, you're not talking about it. I mean, it's a nickel, for example, here, that's what's doing this very quickly now, and that would be the flood. So that's one thing. The other thing, so that you understand when I talk about Bayes, it's going to be, as I said, consider this basically as a construction model. And the other thing, Other thing you should know about me, I'm really interested in intellectual property. So generally speaking, I'm interested in that, but particular property. And so let me give you an example so that you're all on the same page, because it's going to be pretty abstract pretty soon. But one example that hopefully you can follow me. And if you do that, then basically you can make a picture. So let's start with an SDE. I hope you can read this. So it's a drift term and noise, Brownian motion. Right? And we all know, I mean, there's an initial distribution. By pi, and then there's a pocket blanket here. I hope I got it right. Right, so this is the divergence, this is the not last formula. The same bubble. Okay, so it sounds good. Now, as I said, typically, we're really interested in the distribution key at later time. And so we can use also for the plug equation to do this directly. Or we run essentially a set of these equations in parallel and call them positives. Right? So then there's a D, X, T, I, the I copy of this process. Also, the noise gets copied, and it's called J actually, because later it's going to be called J, and J goes from 1. Yeah. Oh, J. Right? So, and they all get initialized according to this distribution, all these different at times 0, and IID, independent. So they will stay independent because they don't interact. Right? They're completely independent. That's sort of we trust that somehow if you then consider the empirical measure, which is the sum of all these particles at any time, which is of your delta x minus x j, so this is your delta, you sum over this, so it's just the standard empirical measure. That this will somehow be, in some sense, in the least sense, an approximation of this P. Right? So that's the second step. That's not interacting. So let's try to do something interactive. And I'm sure quite a few have seen this, but maybe not everyone. There are lots of them. I just have to grab one. We take our Fokker-Planck equation up there, the second equation. This one has Fokker-Planck equation. So you slightly rewrite this in sort of divergence form. So the thing I reformulate is distribution term, right? So I write it as a graph log density, factor of half. Because I take the graph log density, I get by differentiating, I get the gradient of pi divided by pi, and that's why I can pull out the pi. Right? And now I can sort of take this as a new right-hand side of the differential equation. So, this is now completely deterministic, so there's no noise anymore. Let's call this head maybe. And it has this drift term. So, and this has the same, I mean, and this variable is initialized at time zero again, according to P. Now this is an ODE, but it's the mean field ODE because it actually depends on PT. Because let's also call this P hat. I mean, PT hat is the law of XT hat. And it actually, since it satisfies the Fokker-Planck equation, it's the same law as the process stochastic polynomial. Now we have a completely deterministic system, except for the initialization, maybe. It's a mean field type because the right hand side depends on the density. And so you see this again and again. Now you can go to a particle perspective by sucking in the index chain. Now that's why, of course, you pay the price, because now you have to sort of let build the hat here. You have to estimate, you close the equations now from these particles, let's say, say a couple of say, copies of it. You have to estimate the density. Right? Now, you could just take the empirical measure as a hat up there, right? That's obviously not a good idea because you can't differentiate the thing. You can use it. So you could do some sort of density estimation to construct the density that belongs to these particles. And then everything is correct. Now what turns out, you shouldn't do this. What you should really estimate, and that's sort of then part of the algorithm design, what you should really estimate is it's called K of X, which is an approximation to this four. So you take the derivative with respect to the K component in X, log P at X. That's what you really estimate, and there are good estimators for this. And you don't actually estimate the density. But that's sort of a side. And it plays now a big role in diffusion. I think that's the new name. Yeah, that's diffusion modeling, right? Is it called now diffusion modeling?
Yes.
Yep, diffusion modeling. Well, previously, what kind of diffusion modeling, right? So, why on earth would you do this? Right, it's similar to what Sean you have done in your talk about, right? You said, let's replace randomness as much as we can. That was one of the key messages from your presentation. Because, basically, I mean, in a way, this is, of course, much easier to see. A set of STDs, they can parallel, you don't have to do that. But they keep wobbling around, and you never quite sure if you're in equilibrium. I mean, you have to test it somehow. They will keep watching it. In a paper with Manfred Opera and Dimitra, the beauty of it is that you see how things interrelate. Because at some point, I mean, of course, in principle at infinity, in practice, if your system is nice, pretty quickly, these particles will arrange itself and then it stops moving. And then you know that you reach equilibrium for this particle system. Of course, this equilibrium can heavily depend on the initialization, and it's all a bit of a mess. It's you know, how many particles you need, etc., etc. So it's not entirely trivial, but you get a very nice equilibrium. And it works marvelously in low dimensions, and as you imagine, it's a bit difficult to manage. There are other variants of this. Same trick. For example, you can put in a sort of a preconditioning here, let's say. That's first. So we can put in a kernel, for example, which doesn't change the equilibrium properties of this system in a way. This is a greater system, including the potential. And then you get signed. There's a certain descent, for example, which I think the story is really, again, that you don't have to activate the quantity to become natural
numbers.
But these are all examples of inequalities. I think what I'm going to do now in my slides is basically walking through this story in the context of that data coming. But if you get that message, essentially, then it's pretty good. It's eventually going to be too fast, and you get lost, and you can really think of someone else. If you can remember this, then you're good. What else should I say before we move on? Other questions? Yes. Yeah.
Interesting.
Oh, this here, this nasty object here. Yeah, we're going to keep this there. Also, I mean, I guess I haven't, you know, I mean, I will mostly talk in the means of this. So, because I don't like to write all these things. That can be a bit confusing, but it's also very heavy, so that it's very, everything becomes very nice and complex. So I will mostly write stuff in this form. Right? And then you have to think about, once in a while, they talk about how to put a particle system into this. But that's a little habit that I always prefer to do. I mean, you can, I mean, as I said, if this is a grain with some potential, you can do this for a sampling complex to be that comes with it, like e to the minus. I mean, it's, for example, for the sake of it. So, if f is minus the gradient of, then this would up to a factor of something minus a distance of half, maybe. Equilibrium method into the minus f to the number of days, so they don't have the distance of half here, so it's a process of factor of half, maybe. And then you can use those particles, they could equilibrate according to the distribution. That would be one example. Basically, what I'm saying is P infinity will look a bit like this. So P to the minus F is this. Yep. Yep. Yes, but I construct in each time step. So if you think of the time stepping procedure, let's do a forward Euler. So this right hand side you compute at the current particle. And for doing so, you have to implement this score estimator where you estimate a function f that is close to what this should be without ever actually computing it. So the neat thing is you do public integration by parsing to get rid of this. So the way you estimate this function f, which then will go in to replace this, you can do purely sample based and not differentiating, not knowing what the distribution is. So, but the score is an approximation of this property. So it's you know, it's a set of function scores to compute angular system will be any such process, and each component is the derivative of this one. Well, they all couple together, right? They're not independent. Yeah. But they evolve in parallel, but they now couple together through this process of through this density. And in the limit, it will become independent again, but not as a finite particle. Well, let's say if you invariant method is concentrated on this particle system will naturally pick this manifold. Whereas with the PDE, you would discretize, right? So, of course, you could do it effectively, whatever, but I mean, you know, for the Planck in more than six dimensions, forget it. Right? Three dimensions already, right? Six, starting in that. Yeah, but that's exactly, I mean, because, in this case, you can certainly do it. But I'm not saying necessarily, I mean, you could only move to this. I mean, this was an example of how this can be related. There will be other cases where you can't actually, you won't be able to do independent copies. I mean, here we have the reference of the independent deep process. For that reason, maybe not such a perfect example. But even then, I mean, if you run it, it looks beautiful, right? These particles just move and giggle, and then, okay, and you're done. No giggling around anymore. I mean, if you have to test two copies, they will always still go in. Yeah, I mean, sure, I mean, it's kind of shaped now you get into computer science, right? I mean, the example of you run this is not a problem. I mean, it's all still on my laptop. Ultimately, actually, it's a good point. You have a good point there. Because in practice, what you're going to do, I mean, I talk always about the mean theory, but in practice, you want to have these things run with very few particles. So let's take, probably you heard it before, but the net office, for example. Not doing this for the proper time, so that's a different story, but the algorithms, as I'm saying there, when you actually estimate data, they do it in billion degrees of freedom, they do it on an axis in billion degrees of freedom, and they can maybe run 100 copies, or 200 copies. So J is 200, K, I mean, the index of the existing event. So it's way out there. Still, the story typically is that they do an approximate base computation, but they don't do this in this limit. But I think what the hope is that you maybe have still some, at least some things say about this I will say a little bit about this later. Because clearly from the method that we expect, you know, the degree of small parts, and hopefully also some of the so that's what we're going to talk about today. I saw my slide. Oh, right. We found out. Oh, I found out. So I meant to do the slide. So anyway, I'll look at you for now. Okay. In the mean field limit, or in the finite part. So you back it in somehow. Yeah, somebody. That's another good question. So you get creative there. translating the noise. I would imagine that actually this equation could be potentially different. At least as long as the equilibrium. Yeah? Once the equilibrium, you might be okay. But this can have some speed. I mean, if this is the third half, you know, speed contribution, then that would be fine.
Yep. So,
the time step could be.
Yeah.
You might have to use the time
step.
Okay. Yeah, that's another issue.
Right, so
spatial description. With the particle distribution, you can think of it as three methods, right? If you come from, if you think of proper planning, because that's the positive function, and you have the proper planning equation, and that's all the planning equation on the grid. But basically, what I'm talking about is a mesh free
method. Right, discretizing.
Right, so now we take it. So, how do we get this? Nathan, can you? All right, so this is the plan for the whole, right? If you ever get to it. So, I'm going to start out with basically a very high level view of what data simulation is. I will give you a few examples. And then, in the second part, I will talk about one of the popular methods in this field, which is easy to explain. It leads to a very interesting inductive particle system, and it's also to understand it in a theoretical or practical way. There's still a lot to do there. But basically, this ENTS business is around 1996 in the geoscience community, kind of explored into what kind of inductive particle system we possibly find to do based on the simulation. There's a whole zoo of methods now, including I'm not going to go into that, so I will skip to the ENTS, but I will point out why it is a good method. And I will also make it say, what can it cost? I mean, where are the pitfalls? I mean, what's the system? But I don't know. We don't have the plan. And then we'll go on to get us into part three, where I will say a bit about control. How we can use control theory or control approximations to prove actually the problem on some of the time of this will be with the data system control, so it's aspect of control theory, data system control. And it will have a lot to do with coupling of methods. So basically, what we're going to do eventually is an approximation to the equation of the because basically, we'll see in a minute, the whole business can first, data simulation first, resolve in a sequence of methods. And then, if you want to get it into the equation, somehow have to connect these methods by equation. So typically, in data simulation, part of it comes, if you're lucky, by some sort of equation like this, if it's time continuous or even just a discrete update of some density, and neither this nor that or any of this that I thought otherwise is actually known.
The fun of it.
I mean, this example again is a bit confusing, but like maybe give you a little bit more clue, because here we actually started with a nice XD, and it looks like you made all of our visibility. In general, this nice XD picture was actually true. And there's a pretty nasty paper we wrote in the library with Andrew. It's a podcast, but it's called a new field picture in the glorious detail. Not so much, I mean, not the third part, but I mean, as I said, part two, part one is not here.
No.
Okay. So what is data assimilation? It's basically doing two things sequentially. So it's definitely something sequential. Typically, it's the first step. So n is a degradation index, or it can be a time index, but it's not necessary. I mean, it can also just an algorithmic time. Like when we talk about optimization, you know, algorithmic index. So there's what we're gonna call, you know, the kind of comes from the meteorological background, where data assimilation comes from, originates from in this notion. We have a predictor set, we basically have a variable. It will become a random, I mean, pretty much like, so that what I denoted X here is now the B. For the rest of the time being, this is B. And so, basically, you turn the current Vn, into some state, Vn or whatever, to a new state, which is has a hat. For reference, because this notation hopefully it will keep throughout, is sort of, okay, so we got a prediction step. Let Vn to Vn plus 1 hat. And then there's, again, methodology jargon analysis. That's where the data comes in, typically. Something else, some adjustments, which closes the cycle, so to speak, which turns the hat into the non-hat at the same moment. I mean, that's just indexing is probably the topic, right? But so these are the two steps. It's basically completely your choice what to do. The important thing is not just one thing, it's two things. Of course, you could maybe throw in a third step, but let's see. And that actually could be controlled, for example, something controlled. So here, you stick to sort of prediction will really, for example, prediction could be discussion as to do, right? This is the prediction. And let's say the Vn would be the state here at some time. And you run your FDE system forward in time and you get a new distribution. Right? Of course, you could use the infinity, but in data simulation, you actually got to bring in the data to sort of bring it somehow back to some observed data. Right? So the error is also bigger than DD. I will stick to the three times of easier. They are beautiful continuous time formulations, but easier. We're going to use them out, so it's going to be discrete. As I already said, it's then n can be critical or can be some algorithmic indexing. Okay, so now let me give you a few examples. I'm going to play this. Yep, we'll be in there. Yeah. Well, okay, so I mean, you could say this is maybe representing more than that. It could be, yeah, no, it could be, yeah, so, what do you want me to say? I certainly the F's not going to be the true F, right? Yeah. But, I mean, it could be a reduced model, right? People do this, right? So, data assimilation for reduced model. So, it could be, and then, of course, you have to ask yourself, and that's exactly where the frequentist point of view comes in, what is the bias being introduced? And how big is it compared to all the other errors we do? Yeah. That's the fun question, right? Because you have all sort of errors. I mean, you have the observation errors, you have model errors, and I mean, we always have our preferred little feature, I mean, like our model. Then we tune this model to the epsilon, and study it to the epsilon, but then some data doesn't come in and says, oh, you know, I really my data, so why should I, you know, spend all this time? So this makes it exactly interesting, right? Because if you just were to look at the prediction, it's your talk essentially, right? So then you could say, this is too high dimensional, can I reduce it? What are the errors? And now we're gonna bring in every that's sort of, or every so often you're gonna bring in some observations and gonna see how they can help actually also make your business methods. Yeah, you'll see several examples in a minute. Traditionally, it's just quotation marks data space. So as I said, we have these two sets. And so prediction typically in this context is sort of a microprocessor process. It can use the noise out and it just has to come to the system. It's discretized, I mean, the OD system, the PD system, discretizing pilot, and then the end of the quickly solved. So, all like everything else, the right hand side, it can be a bit noise, it can be a discretized version of the SD system, whatever you like, whatever your predictive system is. And then, if you just do pure prediction, then you've given yourself the initial variable and its distribution, and then you want to predict again, and then exactly in this picture. Now there comes data, and it's its own world. Right? Inverse columns is a huge field on its own. You don't even need A just on its own. You know, this is a very simple inverse column here that we're going to mostly consider. You have a column. And this doesn't need to be a state variable, anything. This is something you want to try to infer. You have a forward operator H with its own error, possibly, and you can walk a PD, whatever, and then you observe when the P is the Y, and some exit noise. And again, nice simple, this is going to be good. The frequentist point of view on all of this means that you assume that there is actually a V data, which is a true value, and so the actual observations you really can measure are in this ideal world plus realization of, which I also call data. Because I want to eventually get both together, but I could at this point I could use the statistics. And then you want to learn something about the V data from such observations. And so, of course, if you're familiar, I mean, the Bayesian machinery then says, okay, set a prior on this variable. This implies some likelihood function, and then I do the probability theory, and you get the conditional distribution in the position on the data. But in a way, if you then take the map estimate of this, then that's an estimate. And then you can study that estimate depends on the data, then you can study the properties of that estimate. But anyway, so now let's. So we have these big, both these fields on their own, and now we're going to just put them together. So we're going to always, I mean, this is now state estimation for now. So you assume that at Vn, and maybe I keep this also, that the notations there for the rest of the time being. So the law of Vn will be denoted by V. And the law of hat and will be divided by we denote the distribution. There was a P and this is the good. So then, you do a step of your market prediction process, it's to the right hand set of one, and it's distributed in principle. And that distribution you really need now, because we opt for the Bayesian inference picture. So the way we're going to update the state is using this formula. So you take the distribution you get from the distribution set as a prior, and we take the likelihood function that comes with our columns, in this case, the minus here, the negative log likelihood function, and then this is here, this here, right? And so then you end up with a new distribution, minus of one, which is the posterior, given your prior from the model, given the likelihood of the curve of the mass. So now the catch is, I wrote down here V n plus 1 statistically distributed according to this law. We have the law. Bayes' theorem gives us that law. Why we could put it all the things here. What we don't have is a subset. Anyway, so the thing is that yes, I have a law, but it doesn't tell me how to actually do this, right? So I have a law for this and I have a law for this, but when I want to go from here to here, I need a joint distribution. If I want to get a mean field process, I have to find or define myself a joint distribution, too, and then I can do the Markov check. But for now, Bayes' theorem gives, I mean, I got this distribution from my prediction process, and this distribution from Bayes' theorem. So I have two marginals, and I need a cutting. That's what makes the whole thing interesting. If you want to do the mean field stuff, I mean, if you want to stay completely on the world of density, you're fine, but then you use like a lot of no dimensions you can apply the fault and you eventually will see an example of this as a calculator and you can do it. Anyway, so here's another example. So think of neural networks, like the things that look at the so G, let's say, is your preferred neural network. X is the input, Z is now the output, and Z are the parameters, all the connectors. And we observe or we given input output gap. Right? So
that's paths.
And so that's in a way our data. And interestingly enough, in this world of machine learning, I think there's never an assumption that there's a measurement. So the data is there. In fact, what assumes, I mean, if you put your, I mean, my thinking at least in the world of assimilation is that you say there's actually a model error, the G is not the exact function. So the empirical loss is sort of saying, okay, there is actually some Gaussian random error in Z and the relation to Z. So it's more like a model error, not the data error. But anyway, it gives you whatever error you assume, it gives you this minimization time, right? That you also know. And now we can do data simulation. Right? I mean, you cannot just do stochastic gradient descent, you can do stochastic gradient descent, and so on. So, what is the prediction set? I mean, Z is now the variable of interest. Right? So, these are the parameters we want to estimate. Now it's parameters. And parameters don't move. So, there's no dynamics. Right? So it's just fixed. Or not. Gonna make a move in a minute. So in a true picture, parameters will move, so there's no prediction step. So the first step becomes trivial. But it's still a distribution, right? So we're still talking about not, I mean, if you use stochastic gradient descent, you take one parameter value of the initial value, and then you do stochastic gradient descent, and you get a sequence of numbers. In this picture, the mean field picture, we get a sequence of distributions, which hopefully will convert to what? If you're lucky, when you do the sequence of steps here, so nothing is happening here, and here you, maybe I should say, because the purpose is given answer, I pretend now that this loss function, the contribution is a loss function at each iteration, or each time you get, or whatever, how you numbered your pairs, that you then do a Bayesian, and that's why I'm saying I'm pretty liberal on the other sort of this building of potential, I mean of distribution, I mean more like a circuit, but it's a Bayesian intro, expired. So e to the minus L and plus 1. So you take this as a negative Laplace function. So what could you expect in the end? If you do this, if somebody gives you enough data, then right, so the support loop thing, you know this by base theorem, I mean, this is sort of the base theorem. You know that the support, the variance is shrinking, right? Each time you do this, the variance is definitely shrinking, and if you keep doing this and something gives you more and more data, it will shrink to the problem. And it could be the minimum. But if you stop early, the nice thing about this is, of course, if you do stochastically in the sand, it will stop somewhere, and then, okay, you're there. But what? I mean, you don't know if you the local minima or where you are. Because here, in principle, because this is it's cheating, right? So if you were able to do this computationally, this would be really correct, right? You find all local minima. You know, because you're exploring everything, right? If you have a variable. So, but you would really see uncertainty, like how much you know, how far you actually contracted given the data. But it gives you a bit more than potential gain. Then, also what we find eventually, that we will implement it in a completely derivative-free way. So that we won't do any derivative. It's just this likeness. So you only need to be able to access the output of the neural network. Of course, if it's a neural network, you can do that computation if you like it. But in other cases, you might not have a potential. No. Each time something else. No, otherwise. No, this is X and Z. Somebody gives me, like, you know, the handwritten numbers and then the classification of the neural network. No. It's each time another one. In this context, it's each time you have like somebody gives you 100 of these pairs. I mean, supervised learning, and then they all different. So in this case, it's really each time something different. Now, you indeed, I mean, it's actually the next thing you can also play it and say, if I want to minimize an arbitrary cost function, you can play again the same game. And then now there's actually no data, right? So now we do data assimilation without data. It's more exciting. And I told myself a secret just a minute ago, right? But anyway, so you can do gradient descent on it, right? And this now, this is the whole cost function, right? I mean, basically, I could do this with the same function I defined previously when I take all the pairs data points, I mean, all the pairs of it's handwritten digits and classification. If I pile this whole cost function of caregivers together, that would be my U. So not just one sequential cost function. So I would put this whole thing in one big cost function. Of course, nobody really does it, but let's forget about this aspect for a moment. If you were then to do gradient descent on this, then it would be kind of a derivative. Right? One thing, maybe not so bad. But the thing is really bad, it's not affine and bad. Right? So if you change your coordinates in a fine way, the method will look different. And that's the problem that you have a potential cost function that is very narrow in one direction, very wide in another one. Then this tau n has to be very small. You never got to explore the wide as an expert in the wide direction. It's well known. For some reason, you're going that low, so this is your problem. I don't understand it. But Sean and Emir have worked a lot on this now for reinforcement learning. It's exactly the trick, the SIP algorithm. Yeah, so it's exactly this idea. Get something and find in there. Right? So that it doesn't depend on how you scale the variables you're interested in. Your algorithm will work in the same way. It's a very good algorithm. Obviously, which of course Newton's method gives you, right? Because Newton's method starts in a preconditional there, the inverse of the Hessian, and then you have the second order derivative, and you have to invert the matrix. Of course, the method allows people to have a lot of clever tricks, update, random update, you name it. But still, it's a bit painful. You still definitely need the first order derivative. We will do it completely derivative-free, no matrix inversion. We're going to do it by injecting particles. Derivative-free, affine invariant. And the idea is really to put it again, throw it at this potential basis step. Right? Now, the predictive step here should be zero as well. Because this is a parameter again, you try to infer. So there should be no dynamics. But it makes a lot of sense to actually add dynamics. Right? A little bit noise. For example, to explore. Of course, that would exactly have the effect that things giggling around and you're not quite sure when you reach, but you can maybe shrink the step size. So anyway, so you can now also start playing around with the dynamics. As long as you still can guarantee your asymptotically will converge. Now, basically, in the mean field limit, it shouldn't make any difference. The half comes in, then when you have finitely many particles, as I said, you want to have really just a few, possibly, then these kind of tricks can really make a difference. And then the second step is, again, just to sort of kill them. But now it's really what Maya basically what you are after, right? So now you reinsert the data again and again. I mean, there's no data here, but you reinsert the function again and again with a small step size, like you do it for calculating extent. It's now a mean field version of the calculating extent. And again, if you do this to infinity, then, I mean, here I should probably have it. To one, but normally one, right? So, and then you, as you keep going, you shrink, you shrink, you shrink, right? So, yes, so exactly. Well, it comes in now. I would take, So now, this would, I mean, if you back to this input-output pair, so then there would be all input-output pairs would be in there. So you have all the data there. And then the thing is a little tau, a little time step. So I take the complete likelihood, which contains all the data. Oh, it's the cost function. I mean, it's basically the cost function, right? So you would be the sum z n dagger minus g x dagger n v over all n. Right, so I take all my samples, right? I compute for a given v, I compute what this number is. For a given v is the parameter of the network, all the parameters of the network. I compute this over all samples I have, and that gives me a number. Well, in the one case I cycle through, I only take one element out of the sum and then I cycle through it. Or I take everything together, but then I take small steps in the whole set. And I reinsert the same data again and again. That was just an example. Can be any cost function. It could be. You did a cost function. You can just do it.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a meaning. I mean, it's not a new technique. I mean, it's all about describing it's a meaning.
Right?
Just in the framework. So this is noise, and this is the step size, and of course it's a bit like stochastic in the sense, if you really want to add up a minimum, then you have to shrink the step size, right? So that the noise asymptotically disappears. Yes. Here comes more stuff, right? But as I said, now you can start playing with it. So if you don't like noise, you add you inflate your ensemble in a way. This is now sort of, it's almost acting like noise. It's sort of almost trying to do what I did here. I mean, I basically had noise, and then I replaced it by this term. It also has an inflating aspect. And for Gaussian distribution, that's a good question for you guys. If this is to replace my previous noise, and I go this deterministic way of replacing SF digits here, in the focal concentration, drift chrome is here, F is zero, what should be here, right? I mean, is there something missing, or would this behave essentially, would do the same thing, inflating the variance as Raleigh motion does? Everything Gaussian, right? V is Gaussian distributed. And this is constant update, nothing changing, and this is to mimic the inflation I get from adding noise in the mean field limit again on the density picture. Is that what should come out of this formulation there, or is something missing? So here's the log of the density, this is Gaussian, and then you take the gradient. So what do you get when you take the log of the Gaussian and then the gradient? You get, yes, I mean, not that's cheap. You're not allowed to answer that. Okay, please go ahead. I mean, I guess I could say some more soon. I mean, I'm going anywhere. Anyway, what's the answer? So the inverse of the program. So there should actually be the inverse of the covariance matrix of this random variable that's Gaussian distribution. And then it would do exactly the same thing as if you had noise, which I had in the previous one. Alright? It's a little calculation, a little homework. But this is then an example of a mean field equation, okay? Because replacing the noise by this term with the covariance matrix, you need to have the first order in the first 2 moments. But if you have interacting particles, you can easily estimate these things. So that's what the beauty of it. Now, this without the noise is a multiplicative noise, then, because basically it means that actually you could add the covariance matrix square here. Now, not the inverse. And then have it here, say, with the T. I change my diffusion process by making it now depending on the distribution itself. So I change my SDE to a mean field SDE. And again, if I forget about this term, just look at this, then I can, this term now gives me a really nice term here because it has, I mean, if this is Gaussian distributed, inverse covariance matrix has the covariance matrix, and you get exactly this inflation. This is nice multiplicative inflation. correlated love it. They do this all the time. And I think it has to do with the frequencies expected to have to obey. Look at this. Anyway, so if you could do this all for optimization. You can also add this anywhere you want. And again, notation, right? So, for later, if I have such a distribution, the first two moments I will denote by n mu. So this is the mean of the variable z at time n. I will also have the covariance matrix eventually. Will be denoted by this. And the first two moments here, I'll just give it a hat. I mean, this n variable, a picture of z still here, and the same here. Right, so I will use these notations for, of course, the second order, because that's eventually not today, maybe. We will get to that we will stand in the next week. You can, of course, calculate that too. I mean, the mean is not changing under this, but it's implementing the program, right? So, heading on to the top. Now, inspired by Sean's talk, I thought, oh, let's just spin the stuff around. Yeah, I mean, you couldn't do it with a better stuff, right? So you have your states, you just start spinning them around. I mean, you change, I mean, you spin the rubber over Cambridge, over to New York City or something, it wouldn't work, yeah? And then let's say we talk about here, in the context of optimization or learning something, and the distribution is sort of artificial and stuff is there to explore the landscape, then why not spin this stuff around? Because I think it's pretty much, you know, you had one spinning vector, but you could have, of course, the mean field spinning around, and of course, eventually you would have just a heat bucket that's spinning, maybe. And again, the trick is to do with all the derivative things. So I think it will be extreme sequel and seeking whatever version of five or something that you get out of these things. So there's a whole thing of sort of things you can do. The last example I want to give you is maybe another way, optimal control, no bound basis here. So we have a dynamical system. That's the state propagation and u is the control. And the control is deterministic, so it depends on the current state. And v is to be learned, but it's parameterized by v. Right? So v is now again a set of parameters. It's not a state, but it's the one that controls our control. Okay, so what are we going to do about this? So we have some cost functional. It basically tells us if we were in state X and we would use control U, that's the price we pay. And let's say we have this for a term. I mean, we won't do this over a certain window. And we kind of let the window go to infinity. Just keep going. And so, somehow we want to find, I mean, this all depends implicitly on the V. I mean, through these iterations, everything, I mean, let's say I give you an initial X, then you get a monstrous optimization problem. Right? But ultimately, you can write it down just as a function of V, and maybe the initial condition, but let's forget about X mod. So. Okay. So we're not going to want to do this, but we're going to do again this sort of iterative approach. So the prediction step is now the parameters. I mean, so the parameters that are distributed is the current learned distribution in our control term. Again, here I assume I don't do anything, but I could add a little bit of noise here, a bit of correlation, whatever you want. And then, given these parameters, then somebody gives me the state, and then I get control, I get the best predicted somebody says just these things, I don't even know it. I have to know it explicitly, I suppose. And then in my analysis step, okay, I just now say, for this single step, I evaluate the cost. Right? I mean, how good is this? Over the distribution of all the parameters I currently have. And I treat it again with a Bayesian inference. I treat the cost function, I assume that it's of course normalized.
Of course, yeah.
There's some assumption behind it. This thing exists, right? This is normalizable for the set of parameters I have. But that's a super true. Then basically, I update my parameters according to Bayesian. I mean, pretty general interpretation.
Oh.
And then again, I get a sequence of distributions. And eventually, it should settle at some parameter, which is the inverse of my cost function. What a nasty question you're asking. I mean, it's a mathematician, I say, it has to be. It's just a matter of how long it's going to take you. I mean, how many particles? I did it for linear system, it works. Yeah. Of course, I'm not sure. I mean, this kind of effect should be the same minimizer. It could, right? I mean, then standard. Yeah. So, okay. So, this is X only. Yeah. Yeah. So I can throw in more parameters, right? So I can take it out of the complicated. Okay. So of course this is all abstract nonsense, right? Because it's the thing that set up all these cool forms. Actually, there's another thing, of course, here that since we not, I mean, want to run like your wind farms. I mean, they only should be. Maybe one, I mean, you want to have one state in the end. So, but of course, since you, this is a distribution, right? So we have also a whole distribution of these, right? And then you pick one for the next state. The next state is picked out of all the possible states that could come out of the current size of the parameter configuration. Otherwise, the thing would explode. But otherwise, you also have to cut all the states. That's the choice to make. So you basically pick the control that you then continue with. Right, so in your car, if you sit in your car and your computer in the background is going to maybe use set of arrangements that could be the choice. But in the end, you have to decide where you're going to go. I think that's also what we as humans do, right? I mean, we come up with a whole set of options, and then in the end, of course, we have to pick one, right? We have to do something. So that's what's basically what this is doing. And you do it with the best knowledge you have currently gained over the platform. But eventually, of course, it will settle down, and then maybe it just gives you one choice because you have to optimal control the one that's going to be based on that thing. Well, these are independent samples. X is fixed, right? This is so the chosen X is, I mean, this is. You mean this stuff here? Oh yeah, they will come eventually. Not yet. I mean, as I said, I'm lazy, right? So I first do mean field, and then eventually, if we ever get to it, then I will tell you how to easily put this onto the thing, right? But I, yeah. So we will get there. But I'm just saying. I mean, basically, what I'm trying to get is, if you find a good algorithm for these, you know, basically for this step, I mean, this is all easy, right? So that's my part. At least if you like particles, I mean, the Markov process naturally particleizes. So the hard bit is really this one to get a good algorithm for that. Of course, people stand sequential on the color, right? It's a long history of that sequential on the color graph. And indeed, a lot of stuff has been analogy in similar fashion discussed in this context, except it came from Monte Carlo, as a scale up, it's a beautiful method, but it's a much lower dimension of scale right? I'm close to getting to that subject. So basically, whatever of these examples you take, and whatever you like to put on, we have these sequence of variables, but rather, we actually this isn't so much talk about the variables of this distribution. We rather get it lost, a sequence of lost, initial lost, analysis lost, etc. But as I said, if you want to really connect this into a markup process, you have to connect this. And that's what, of course, where our thing comes from. I mean, how to connect it on the level of stochastic processes. So basically, coupling for some distributed. So that's just, again, for the first question, to say we can do this, and it will be typically mean field effect. So we've seen already an example for a predictive step where it becomes mean field. And no noise, for example, if you start here, if your prediction process is an FDE, you can eliminate the noise, go mean field, or you don't like this mean field and you just keep the noise. There's typically sort of a bit of a trade-off with how much sort of noise you add, and maybe how independent the particles become, and vice versa. But that's basically, again, this sort of given from one or another information. Or I gave you another example with this inflation that meteorologists use. I started here with the identity plus some noise, prior noise, and I said I can replace this on a retired assumption by scaling and covariance. So that is already something that you usually apply because you have to then distribute the history for just a moment, but still you have to basically distribute. But then you don't need noise. Generally, these days, we like to like form. I'm on the same boat. I like to get rid of old noise as much as possible. Sometimes it's good to have noise. But generally, we push pretty much all noise into this game and not for the use. All right. So, if we would have such functions, then everything else falls out naturally, right? Now we can copy the function. We have capital K copies. We introduce the empirical distribution. With these particles, this will replace these distributions here. There's a capital J here indicating that there's definitely the empirical measure. In principle, I also said it's not quite always possible, you just stuck it in. And then here's your individual particle.
Okay.
Very abstract. It's needed. You have to do something else that would lead to a change in the path, etc., etc. That's it. And now you can have a new simulation. Any questions about the video? So there are a lot of questions arising from this. You can now say, if I have such an interesting particle system under the applied method, which is what we have, certainly speaking, how you can do analysis, what you can take, does it go to the improvement? What is the stability of the whole thing, right? Especially if there is actually an interesting prediction step, right, that is killing your certainty, right? So if there's not unstable, but there's certainly a stochastic process increases uncertainty, like rapid forecasting, like the audit system. We have sort of expanding stochastic process, then data simulation, they pull it down again. So you get all these interesting questions about consistent theory, domain control theories, and then data filtering. All come up here, and you can also do sort of like the particle system. You can really look at the dependency on the data. I mean, that's, I think, really good. Frequentist perspective comes in because at the Bayesian you typically say, okay, I have some data and I do my Bayesian inference, but I analyze it, it's like posterior is closed, like posterior is closed to the ear posterior. But again, I think the important point is to understand these algorithms really over the whole distribution of possible observations. And then say something about, let's say you take the mean as an estimator, how good is this mean relative to the real state of, let's say, the value. It's an interesting discussion, actually. I was at a meeting in Reading, one of the satellites, the new field where they have 1 month long workshops, like, oh no, programs, like, they have 6 months, but then there's this 1 month
workshop.
And it wasn't geophysical certificates. And there was the head of the data simulation unit for the nuclear method, of course, there. And she was sort of saying, I can't get my researchers to trust or believe probabilistic forecasts. They don't want it. I mean, they don't believe it. I mean, they say you have to give me a forecast. I mean, there's nothing probabilistic. I mean, there's only one data. I mean, how can you suddenly talk about probabilistic forecasts, right? And I think that boils down, again, to the Bayesian frequentist point of view, right? Because, yes, the UK Met or any office is now one of the system. So you could say they're doing Bayesian inference. But I think the practitioners or the forecasters, so you take this as a measure of frequency uncertainty. So the whole idea that the Bayesian uncertainty covers the frequency uncertainty. And but otherwise they take their best forecast, which mostly actually are a little bit higher than the simulation than the ensemble data system, that's right. That's the forecast. And the ensemble system is not really interpreted in a Bayesian, but really as a measure of whether, you know, that gives you the confidence intervals or characterize the confidence you perform over positive measurements you can have instead of the measurements that you have. But this is a really deep discussion apparently going on at the UK Metals, whether they want to go base or frequency or whatever. That's my interpretation actually. Really interesting. I do. Mm-hmm. It's very tactical, and of course, if you look at the UK Metals or any of these communities, they really tune and carefully check against data. Calibration is a huge issue, and it's all, I think, is actually the frequentist perspective, right? I mean, so that you can be, in that sense, confident about your forecast. We will get to the specs on Friday because I'm not going to do anything else today, except that on the algorithm, you also have a lot of questions. Talk about approximation errors, cosmological errors, probability, stability, you know, actually, in various. So they're work for PhD students and postdocs forever. Not forever maybe, but I think so. But so I haven't given you any algorithm and anything you could actually do. So and it's of course closer than tell you what you expect on Friday morning at 9 o'clock. Right? So, I'm curious to see who's going to be there at 9 o'clock. It's a cool stuff to come. Right? This is all just the problem. So basically, the next thing is about this method of your science that developed the system. Come and build up. Of course, if you've seen it, then you can stick it there. If you haven't seen it, it's pretty cool. And then maybe the thing that's for people that know the EMTS, maybe interest, why using the anchor and why I will give you a beautiful example of why you not use the anchor, and I will give you hopefully some reasons why the EMTS is the huge success and why so why the. And then if you ever get, I don't think we will do, it's like again your focus, it's like your bootcamp stuff where we actually also have a special project on Potsdam. So I'm not going to answer it. So that would be left there for sure. But anyway, that's some style of accessory. So there's an autonomous driving session here on, it's actually part of the control deep dive. It's on Wednesday for the flyers outside. I think you can also find it on there. I think it's going to be pretty cool. There are some people from a company from Oxford coming in. They actually do autonomous driving, I suppose, right? And they will talk about their work, their services. So it's going to be really cool. It's also a really deep dive, of course, going on next week. Anyway, so check it out and register. It's going to be, I think, it's good for something. That's
it.
Yeah. Yes, except the nice thing is the look hidden underneath we sort of make it out to observation, but we never explicitly use it. So and that's the next Friday morning. So in principle, yes, there is, but we don't do it. I mean, there's no variation stuff in there. So it's a little bit different. But yes, we will make Gaussian approximations. In devising algorithms, but the variables you propagate, they're not Gaussian. That's an interesting thing. So you can apply it to any variables, but it's basically a bit more like the regression type things you would do, and you don't rely on Gaussian approximation. No. Today, I mean, I just put down this mistake. I will need them eventually, but I'm not saying that these variables are Gaussian. No, I mean, you mean to do weak, I mean, to do what? I mean, okay, here in this case, yes, right, yes. Yeah, so we won't get to it, but it's actually what you're doing is there's no, it's the prediction step is trivial and nothing happens. You're doing actually a great experiment in several rounds. Okay. And you know that it converges, right? And it's also doing it. So it's triple round. Well, I mean, as I said, I mean, this, there's no transition code here, right? So this is, I mean, if you add, I'm not sure if you add noise, for example, there would that be too. But if there's, I mean, if the prediction step is just identity, then you have this other thing, essentially. You get something like this, right? Created from in the cost function. Not buffer style, but official. Yeah, I mean, that was, the infinite time, yeah. So, well, I could then maybe cycle across this window, I mean, like, do the cycling again. I mean, going this and this, right? I mean, like, going through, but I could also take the whole window and cycle over the window. But again, this was sequentially in the cost. I take the whole cost and then go incrementally in the total cost. Yeah, we have to, I mean, something to play on, but yeah. Okay. Yeah, I think so.